Good evening, church. Welcome to Price Hill. For those of you who have never been here before, this is indeed your Price Hill campus. I'm Daniel, our campus pastor here, and we're glad to have you here. Tonight is going to be a very special night. Joe, thank you for that prelude. We at Price Hill, we never have a prelude. We have a band jam, and then we just go, okay? And so tonight, we're asking you to extend and receive the grace of God, not only for you on this Ash Wednesday, but also for the ways in which people worship and connect and experience God. There are some of you here tonight who experience God in very quiet and subdued ways. And there are others who are very expressive and encounter God in sometimes the noise. We believe that there's no right or wrong way to experience God. We are gathered together tonight as one people, saved by Jesus, to remember and reflect and remember where Jesus is and where we are. So we want to invite you tonight to just come back to Him, surrender all to Him as we enter into this time of worship.
Lord, we gather to be in your sight. We gather to get a glimmer of who you are in our lives and who you call us to be. So, Lord, I ask that you allow the Holy Spirit to wash over us this evening. For those of us who come shaky and insecure, allow us to be reassured that you're in heaven above us. And Lord, as we gather, let us be the people that see the very face of Jesus Christ in our time of worship. Lord, we come as your children, and we gather in your name. And all God's people said, amen. Good evening. I didn't say good morning. Isn't that awesome? I had to celebrate. My name's Pastor Brent, and I'm the executive pastor here at Shiloh, and I just want to start off this evening talking about what Lent is. I think I've talked to a number of people, and some people celebrate Lent, and some don't, and some people don't really know what it is except for that thing that you find in the bottom of your pocket. I think it's because we're a very forgetful people. We're people that need to be reminded. And so we set apart certain seasons of the year to focus and be reminded of certain practices and certain beliefs. And so Lent is one of those. And what makes tonight extremely special is today is the first day of Lent. And so we gather as a community, as a church, as kingdom builders, to be still and say, today is the first day of Lent, and we're about to start a journey, and we're not on this alone, and so we come together to start this Lenten journey. Lent, it's a time of preparing ourselves for Easter, but I think so often when we talk about preparing, we act like it's a waiting room, that it's just about the time until Easter comes, but that's not what Lent is about. Lent is a time of preparation. It's a time where we are supposed to be actually preparing ourselves for Easter. It's 40 days. So who's giving things up for Lent? Anybody? Or maybe taking some things on? And so for those of us who are doing that, we're doing that for 40 days. If you're going to do it on Sundays, it's 47 days. It's confusing. But the idea in that practice is that when we arrive on Easter morning, we arrive hungry for the resurrection. We arrive hungry for Jesus Christ to be resurrected in our lives, not just historically in the Bible. And so that's what this season is. It's a season where we find ourselves in preparation. So when we get to Easter, we find ourselves downright starving for Jesus Christ. And so this season starts today in Shiloh on all three of our worship services, we're going to be focused on the series called To Die For. And the premise behind this, it's the understanding that Jesus had some kingdom principles that he literally died for. So each and every Sunday, we're going to talk about what some of those principles are. But the amazing part is, Jesus asked us to do something even harder. He asked us to live for these same principles. When I was reading Ephesians earlier this week, I was reading some words from Paul. And it was Philippians 1. And Paul's wrestling with this. Would it be better to die and go and be with Jesus and come home? Or to be better to live? Hear these words. For I fully expect that hope that I will never be ashamed, but that I will continue to be bold for Christ as I have been in the past. And I will continue to be bold as I move forward. And as I continue to trust that my life will bring honor to Christ, whether I live or die. For me, living means living for Christ. And dying is even better. But if I live, I can do more fruitful work for Christ. So I really don't know which is better. I'm torn between my two desires. I long to go be with Christ, which would be far better for me. Listen to this. But for your sake, it is better that I continue to live. What Paul's saying is that if we choose to continue to live, it can't be for me. It has to be for Christ. So as we gather this entire Lent, as we talk about what it means to die for and to live for, it's to live for Christ. And so if we're going to be the folks that live for Christ, we're the people that come into a story that has been going on through history. We get to be this part of the story. We get to stand on the shoulders of those who have come before us. And if we do a decent job, we get to be the shoulders of those who are yet to come to stand on as the faith and the kingdom gets built in and around the world. So let us hear this story. You can follow along on the screens. Now the serpent was more crafty than any of the wild animals, for the Lord God had made. He said to the woman, "Did God really say you must not eat from any tree in the garden? Do you hear it? Can't you just live for you?" The woman said to the serpent, We may eat from the trees in the garden, but God did say, you must not eat fruit from the tree that is in the middle of the garden, and you must not touch it, or you will die. See, Lent, it's all about temptation. It's all about facing what it means to live for Jesus and die to self. "You will not certainly die," the serpent said to the woman, "for God knows that when you eat from it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil." When the woman saw that the fruit of the tree was good for food and pleasing to the eye and also desirable for gaining wisdom, she took some and ate it. She also gave some to her husband. I always love that part because men always nudge their wives at that section. Who was with her, and he ate it. Then the eyes of both of them were opened, and they realized they were naked. So they sewed fig leaves together and made coverings for themselves. The man and his wife heard the sound of the Lord God as he was walking in the garden in the cool of the day, and they hid from the Lord God If you heard God coming and found yourself to be figuratively naked, vulnerable in a way that you want to hide even from God? So among the trees of the garden they hid, but the Lord God called to the man, "Where are you?" If this is your first Lent, I want you to know that God is asking you that question. Where are you? God is calling us all, even if we're willing to try to hide in his garden. And he answered, "I heard you in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked, so I hid." And he said, "Who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten from that tree that I commanded you not to eat from?" See, God loves us enough to give us boundaries. He loves us enough to tell us this is good and this is not good. And the man said, "Well, the woman that you put here with me, she gave me some fruit from the tree. And I ate it." Adam stands before God in all humility. And even if he tries to blame the woman for a half a second, what I hear Adam doing right there is going, "God, I messed up. You told me not to. And I'm standing before you. And I'm telling you I ate it." So as we gather this evening, that's where I want us to start. What do we need to give over to God to start this Lent in a way that makes sense? What do we need to confess to God so we can enter Lent into a new and challenging experience? Not only do we need to give our confession, but this Lent may be a time and space and place where we give of our time, our treasure, and our talent and do a different way so others can experience the season in a brand new way. So the band's going to be leading us in a song as we have time to prayerfully confess to Jesus. Our ushers are going to be coming with the offering plates, and this will be a time where we can hand back what God blessed us with to begin with in a way that shows that we're willing to give of ourselves. So church, are you ready to bow before God and admit that God asked you not to, but you said, "I did anyways"? Let us prepare for this to be a time where we give.
Lost it. Let's bow our heads and give God thanks. Father God, thank you. Thank you for loving us, for caring about us. Thank you for not forgiving up on us, as many people have. We thank you for bringing our campuses together, Lord. We thank you for this offering, Lord. We thank you for this blessing, and we ask that you will build your kingdom forevermore. And Lord, we love you. In Jesus' name we pray. And the church said, amen. Thank you.
God has said, where are you? And I hope that we're saying we're right here. Broken, but we're here. And as an act of saying we're here, let us stand and worship.
So this is a newer song we've been doing at our Delhi campus. I just want to teach you the chorus for it. It's pretty easy. I just want you to be able to sing along with us.
Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ.
There we go. Let's sing that again. You ready?
Go come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ.
I think you got it. Sing, are you hurt?
Are you hurt and broken then? Overwhelmed by the weight of sin? Well, Jesus is calling. To come to the end of yourself. And do you thirst from a drink from the well? Well, Jesus is calling.
I'll sing it out. Oh, come.
Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Yeah.
Leave behind.
Well, come today, there's no reason to wait, 'cause Jesus is calling. Oh, bring your sorrows and trade them for joy. From the ashes a new life is born, 'cause Jesus is calling.
Let's sing it out. Oh, come.
Oh, come to the Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. So come to the altar.
Oh, come.
Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to
You know, I just couldn't help but thinking while I was sitting here tonight that this is the kind of stuff that just makes Jesus smile. You know, when we bring three different worship styles together in one room, when we bring two campuses together, when we become one church, when we value unity over our diversity, I just have to say that this to me is what it looks like to be in the kingdom of God. Yeah, let's give yourselves a hand. Lent is a very special time for me. It's one of those times where I get kind of introspective, and I start looking deep inside, and I start asking the questions I'm not really sure I want to ask the rest of the year. You know, I start looking at the things that are really keeping me from fully living into my God potential, and I start wrestling with the hard stuff, the broken places in my life, and I come to the recognition that, man, I've got a bunch. And the good news is, so do you, right? So I'm in good company tonight that we have said a dozen times that the church is not the place where perfect people come to gather, but the place where broke folk go to find healing and hope, right? The symbol of the ashes has been a symbol of brokenness since the very beginning. And the story that Brent began today in Genesis chapter 3, it goes on to say this: "The Lord God said to the serpent, 'Because you have done this, cursed are you among all the livestock and among all the wild animals. You will crawl on your belly and you will eat the dust all the days of your life. And I will put enmity between you and between the woman and between your offspring and hers. And he will crush your head and you will strike at his heel.' To the woman, he said, 'I will greatly increase your pains in childbearing. With the pain, you will give birth to your children. Your desire will be for your husband and he will rule over you.' To Adam, he said, 'Because you have listened to your wife, you ate from the tree which I commanded you, you must not eat of. Cursed is the ground because of you. Through painful toil, you will eat of it all the days of your life. It will produce thorns and thistles for you, and you will eat of the plants of the field. By the sweat of your brow, you will eat your food until you return to the ground, since it was from where you were taken. For dust you are, and to dust you will return.'" See, dust since the very beginning, since Genesis, dust and ashes have been the symbol of our brokenness and our origins of hurt and pain. The Bible describes that when God created us, that God got down on one knee and he scooped up the dust and the mud and the muck and the mire, that stuff that had no value, that stuff that was just dirty. And God took what was worthless and began to form it. And as God began to form what Ephesians calls his greatest masterpiece, as God began to form it, it began to look a little bit more like you, and a little bit more like you, and a little bit more like us. And God, in God's creative genius, took what was worthless and to be trampled on and created it into something beautiful. But you know, the Bible says that we weren't fully created in God's image until God breathed into us the breath of life. Right? It wasn't until God breathed into us that this muck and this mire and this dirt became the very heartbeat of God. And so we remember that the ashes and the dust are a reminder of who we are apart from God. That apart from God, we are just dust. We are just ashes. Ashes all through the Bible have been a symbol of that brokenness and of repentance. In the Old Testament, in the sacrificial system, when the people would bring an animal to the temple and the animal was sacrificed on the altar and burned, the Bible says that the aroma of the sacrifice would raise up to God's nostrils. But what was left was the ashes. The part that was unacceptable to God. The part that God didn't receive. In the Old Testament, we read about Job and about David, who used ashes as a time of mourning and repentance. Job sat on a pile of ashes and mourned and wailed. And David covered himself in sackcloth and ashes when he was caught in adultery with Bathsheba. These ashes that we wear are more than just a symbol, but they're a reminder of who we are apart from God. I got to do one of the best things ever this week. Every Lent, I always make sure it's my turn to teach preschool praise at our preschool program over at our Delhi campus, because these little preschoolers come in, 3, 4, and 5 year olds, and they come and they sit around the front of the church, and we tell Bible stories, and I always like to do one around Lent, because I get to do the ash, talk to them about the ashes. And they were asking, oh, but I don't want to be dirty. Right? Some of them was like, no, Mom said no. Right? And I said, here's the good news. The good news about these ashes is just like your brokenness, they wash away. So you can go wash your hands. And it's going to remind you of who God was and what God has done for you. These ashes that we will impose tonight, this is an ancient tradition in the church. We're going to, in a few minutes, we're going to invite you to come forward. Our ushers are going to release you kind of starting in the back, and we're going to ask you to come down the middle, and our three pastors will be up here. And if you would like, we will put a sign of the cross on your forehead or on your hand, whichever you would like, as a symbol of who we are apart from God and our need for God's grace and forgiveness. Our desperate need for God, recognizing that over the next 40 days, we're going to spend some time focusing on that need and how God provided all that we needed in the empty tomb. So in here in just a few minutes, we're going to invite you to come forward to do that. If that's not something you want to do, please don't feel like you have to. But we want to invite everybody. You don't have to have it all figured out or have the Bible memorized or anything. This is just for you, kind of a worship time between you and God. These ashes that we're going to use are actually very symbolic. They are the burnt palm branches from previous Palm Sundays. And the reason we do that is because the connection between Palm Sunday and the cross is so important. In Luke chapter 19, it tells us that Jesus rode into town on the donkey, and you know, people were yelling, Hosanna, Hosanna, and it was a parade, and it was this amazing time. And that's the, for preschoolers, that's their favorite part, right? But you know what Luke says? That right after the parade was over, everybody went home. And Jesus went to the top of a hill, and he looked out over the city. And it says, Jesus wept over the city. And he said, if you had only known what would bring you peace, if you had only known who you are apart from me, if you had only known. And so these ashes are also a reminder of how quickly our hearts turn. Because the same people who were yelling Hosanna, just a day later were yelling crucify him. In church, let's be honest, that's us. That's us. We crucify him every time we turn away. And so today, I would just like to invite you to come and receive the ashes. We're going to ask Joe to play just on the organ, just something quiet, something you can kind of worship to. Our ushers are going to invite you to come forward and receive the ashes. And like I said, if that's not something you want to do, feel free to stay at your seat. But we want to invite everyone. And once you get back to your seats, we're gonna finish up. Because here's the good news about Lent. The cross is not the end of the story. Amen? All right.
I might be biased, but we have the baddest church in the city. I don't care about what they're saying. You can't get away with this everywhere. Man, it's good for us to be here. It is good for us to be here in the presence of our Father, and in our presence. We're all on a journey, and we've been on a journey. For some odd reason, God has allowed our lives to coincide in this time and space, at this point in time in history. And the one thing I like about God is that no matter where you start, you can start wherever. It's about how you finish. Amen. And as I'm absorbing just the energy and just feeling the family, I'm like, there are a lot of folk in this room who just would never imagine that they would be together here in this room. Ever. Like ever. But God. When I think about the ways in which God can change your mind and change your heart and cause you to love people you never imagined you'd love, or open yourself up to people you never wanted to be vulnerable to or with, I'm reminded of the very story, the very journey that Brent even started us off with, that we... We are part of a story, probably the greatest story ever told. A story that started at the beginning of time when time was being recorded. A story that goes all the way back in Genesis. A story of love and life, paradise. A story of hope and healing. A story of oneness, complete. In the beginning, we lacked nothing. In the beginning, we had everything we needed and everything we could ever desire. But it's not how you start a thing, it's how you finish a thing. And sometimes we get caught up and distracted and frustrated and upset about the journey, but we have to learn to embrace the journey. God isn't dismayed by our detours or our hiccups or our hangups. As a matter of fact, God, before he ever created, already knew every mistake that we would ever make. Yet he still loved us, still came and died for us, and still gave us his Holy Spirit to lead and guide us even today. So when I think about the goodness of the Lord, I just say it's good for us to be here. Amen? And I just want to be here. I just want to be here. Is that all right? I'm not going to hold you because we got to go. I know. But I do want to read this passage for you just so that you have this scripture in your hearing, and I'll move us on along. We're in Genesis. You heard the story. Something that stands out to me in verses 20 through 24 is this, that Adam took authority and named his wife as if he owned her, as if she was one of the animals. That always strikes me as odd, given that he threw her under the bus. I don't know. I don't know. Just, we'll talk with God about that when we get there. Just let God be God. So he names his wife because she would become the mother of all living things. The Lord God made garments of skin for Adam and his wife and clothed them. And the Lord God said, the man has now become like one of us, like God, knowing both good and evil. Can you imagine never knowing evil and only good? That's what they had. That's what we had in the beginning. It was all good. No evil. I don't know about you, but I'm trying to get back to that. Amen. Where there's sunshine every day. Amen. And plush golf courses. And my favorite team always wins. I'll leave it at that. And your favorite team can win too. And the Lord God said that they have become like one of us, knowing both good and evil, and he must not be allowed to reach out his hand and take also from the tree of life and eat and live forever. God never desired for us to live in the condition of knowing evil forever. Think about that. God never intended for you and me to understand evil forever. There's this moment in time where we understand and we know both good and evil right now. We see it every day. We experience it. Sometimes we've been on the bad side of it. Sometimes we've delivered it. We know evil. But there will come a day when we will know evil no more. So the Lord God banished them, and one translation said, drove them from this garden of paradise to work the ground from which they had been taken. This begins the journey of humanity, brothers and sisters. We understand paradise. It's in our heart. It's written on our DNA. It's in our code. We long for it. We desire for it. And that's why we have to continue to push and fight for it. But that was the beginning. And this is the now. And we are in the middle of a story. And if you get a chance to look at scripture, you'll see that even in Genesis, God was laying out his plan and his love. And even though Adam and Eve sinned and fell short of God's glory, God extended another covenant to them and said, I'm not going to leave you in the ashes. I'm not going to leave you broken and separated from me. So he sent them on a journey. And I believe that when God sent them on the journey, God knew that they would have a craving and a hunger for God, and they will do whatever they could to get back to God. That's what I believe. God sent them on their way. You know, like children are, when they get to a certain age where the parents can't tell them anything. You just got to send them on their way. And the children of Israel came out of that line, and we know that when they went on their way, they performed murders and they did all kinds of things that brought disgrace to God's name. Yet God was still there, loving them and reminding them, I have not forsaken you. I am with you. And they ended up in bondage and slavery, and they cried out to God, God, help us. We know we screwed up, but can you help us? And God delivers them and sends them on their way. And they go out into a wilderness, and they begin to complain and murmur and cuss God. And God said, well, since you don't realize who has helped you, I'll just leave you there for a little while to stew. A 40-year struggle. And in the end, God allowed them to enter this thing called the Promised Land, where they could be prosperous, where they could experience good. And they were there for a while, and they said, God, we no longer want you to be God. We want kings, human kings, to lead us like all these other nations. And God gave them what they wanted. And in that, they forgot about God. They got off track, and they took matters in their own hands, and they ended up tearing everything up, so much so that they were scattered. They were separated. Their enemies would come in and destroy them. And they cried out to God again, God, help us. And in this time, God then uses the prophets. And the prophet's primary message is, listen, if you return to God, God will send you a savior. No matter how bad you've messed up, no matter how far you have fallen, God will be there to raise you up. And so the prophets came and they prophesied about God and the Messiah. And they had to wait for 400 years until the one day when this one guy comes on the scene and he says, now is the time. And this is the place. The kingdom of God is here. Repent and believe this good news. Brothers and sisters, I believe that I hear God saying that to us even now. There are some of us in this room who never imagined that they would be in a room with someone who is white, worshiping with a chancel choir on Ash Wednesday. There are some of us in this room who never imagined that they would come back to Price Hill to be in this church, to hear a praise band open up an Ash Wednesday service. See, God has a funny way of bringing people together and changing their hearts and changing their minds and saying, listen, the kingdom of God is here right now and the kingdom of God is in you. So brothers and sisters, as we begin this Lenten journey in 2017, we need to be reminded of how far we have fallen away from God's glory. We need to be reminded of the ways in which we may break God's heart, but we also need to be reminded that God has never forsaken us. That God says, all you have to do is repent and believe the good news that I am here with you now. And it is in that truth where you and I experience forgiveness for all the things we thought and all of the things that we've done that make us feel like we're in the pit, that make us feel like we're worthless ash. It's in the truth that God is here with us right now. So I want to invite you over the next 40 days as we anticipate Easter, because Resurrection Sunday is coming. I've never been that excited. I feel excited for Resurrection Sunday, for Easter, because the kingdom of God is here right now, and I look at our numbers. We're almost 100 strong, worshiping and praising and saying that we want to begin this season of repentance. And we want to be reminded of who we are and whose we are. And I believe that God is pleased with us. So, church, I want to leave you with this thought. Actually, with this prayer. Can I just pray this prayer over us? Father, as we wake up, as we are awakened by your Spirit, as we are awakened by the reality of this world, Father, do to us what you have done to your family since the beginning of time. Lead us through the good and the bad, through the plenty and the lack. Lead us to face our giants. Lead us to the mountaintop. And wherever you lead us this season, we will be an obedient people. Whatever you ask of us in this season, our answer is already yes and amen. So God, give us the strength to give up what you have asked us to give up. Give us the focus to bring those things into our lives that need to be brought into our lives in this season. I pray that we, Shiloh United Methodist Church, will be a faithful people. And may this Lent be unlike any other season of Lent that we have ever seen or experienced. We ask this in the name of our Lord and our Savior, who gives us hope from this day and forevermore. Amen. Amen.
Please stand and join in singing with me, "I Surrender All," once again.
All to Jesus I surrender, all to Him I freely give. May I ever love and trust Him in His presence daily. Take me now. I surrender all. I surrender all. All to Thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender. To Jesus I surrender, make me Savior wholly Thine. May Thy Holy Spirit fill me, may I know Thy power divine. I surrender. Jesus, I surrender, Lord, I give myself to Thee. Fill me with Thy love and power, let Thy blessing fall on me. I surrender.
Church, may those words be the words that encourage and comfort you this season. Surrender all your hopes, your dreams, your frustrations, and your failures. Remember that if you happen to slip up on the very thing that you promised God you would give up, you were already forgiven before you made the promise. Surrender everything to God this season and see what He does for us this resurrection. Amen. 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 Go in peace.